listening to throughout the day. We've got the theme or the soundtrack to The Martian, the soundtrack to Interstellar, even the soundtrack to The Stranger Things. So hopefully that has lightened the mood a little, and hopefully you all have had the opportunity to enjoy the expo, some of the public pitches, and some of the panel sessions that have occurred throughout the day. Our guest today on stage needs no introduction. In the Forbes innovation list for 2019, he was co-number one on that list with Mr. Jeff Bezos, and if you care to comment on that later, you'll have to. But I will remain silent on that. He's obviously the founder of a few companies you may all be familiar with, like Tesla Motors and SpaceX. He's also spent time on the board of a nonprofit, OpenAI, and sponsored innovative competitions like the Hyperloop Initiative. Elon, thank you so much for being with us today.
Absolutely, thanks for having me.
All right, so we'll just dive right in unless anybody has any objections to that. I just have some questions. We're gonna be talking about primarily innovation, but interspersed amongst some of our questions on innovation will be some questions on leadership, some questions on culture, especially in the small business growing to a large business kind of environment. And then I myself never got these questions until 5 years ago, but I may throw you a couple work-life balance questions, quality of life questions. So without further ado, Elon, a critical question that all businesses face when tackling challenges during product development is, do we invest the time and the resources to do this work internally, or do we contract it out and have an external partner do it with us? Can you talk to the audience a little bit about what kind of decision process you go through, whether you're deciding to do it in one of your companies or contract it out to somebody else?
Well, in the beginning, we try to contract most things out. Both at Tesla and SpaceX, we saw with most things contracted out. And then that didn't succeed. So we insourced more and more of the time. In space particularly, the supply chain is not great. ITAR restricts you to really working with US companies. We're very difficult to work with US companies. Very limited set of suppliers. And to the degree that you have legacy parts, you inherit legacy costs and limitations. And so that required us to insource most of the market. This probably only less than 10% of the market is coming from space supply chain. Some of the automotive supply chain is better, consumer electronics is a lot better. Wherever there's a lot of competition, the supply chain is better. So it really depends on the part. But it's important to bear in mind that legacy components mean legacy cost limitations. If you want to have something revolutionary, you can't do catalog engineering. Catalog engineering is, well, that's limited ingredients.
So the legacy industrial base is fast enough to
the thing is that in a lot of companies, this is, you know, risk-reward asymmetry, where bold moves are, if they go wrong, are punished. And but sort of keeping your head down is not punished. That's not good. That will result in a very conservative outcome. So it has to be a requirement that there is significant investment, and simply the lack of doing something significant is bad. So the big companies just become really conservative over time, and are really the government is a company in the limit. So the government is the biggest company.
So we have some big companies in the audience, but we have a lot of small businesses in the audience.
Right.
So not part of the legacy supply chain for rockets or whatever other innovation you or a company that you are associated with might be producing. Is there some advice or counsel that you can give to some of these small businesses about how to market to growing space partnerships like SpaceX or other companies that might be willing to admit them to the supply chain if they don't have that old thing or that old process mentality?
Well, for SpaceX or Tesla, I mean, if somebody's got a component that's better than what we're making internally, we would love to buy that, for sure. We're preset when it goes down the road, like, what is that name? It's
okay. I look forward to seeing it, and perhaps driving it at some point in the future. So you have to try to teach people en masse different approaches, and just make sure that you reward the right behavior, that the reward structure is incented in the right way. This is incredibly important. Economics 101, whatever you incent is likely to happen. In fact, it would be bizarre if it didn't. So statistically speaking, it will definitely be what happens. So
should have at least a sort of cursory understanding of the whole rocket or the whole car, even though they may have deep expertise in one area. Then they can help tell if they're optimizing for the product as a whole. So, and in general, like you can summarize the key characteristics of each discipline. You can simplify it down to a few principles. It's like Richard Feynman used to say that you really know your subject if you can explain it to a smart 10-year-old. But if you try to sort of disguise your expertise in obscure language, then maybe you don't understand what you're talking about. I'm trying to really view myself as some great expert on leadership, to be frank.
the stuff on there on physics. Okay, so Elon, let's move on a little bit to work-life balance. Do you have a deliberate approach to how you balance your work and the rest of your life? Or do you just kind of have a sense of, hey, I am focusing way too much on work right now, I need a break, or I need to go do something different?
Well, I think my mind goes with the own point of view on this, but I associate it with a life decision. In my case, I actually want to get the most amount done possible. But if you're going to take some breaks, then your sort of amount that you get done is less. So the reason I would take breaks is in order to get more done, basically. That's not everyone's decision. But I have to, a friend of mine was actually last thing we had a vacation where we didn't do work for a week. It was like, well, that'll be like 2,000, maybe 2,000. So like an hospital and now they're in. So maybe I should take another break. of
ecosystem that's represented today, one of the challenges that it faces every day, and would face every day even if the STEM production system across the United States or across the free world was perfect, is a strategic competition for talent. Are there techniques that as you grow from a small business to a large business that you need to change in terms of how you reach out and find that talent in the ecosystem?
Yeah, I mean, first of all, like the things that, if you're wanting to get great engineering talent, then the work itself has to be exciting. The best engineers want to work on the most innovative things. And then as you add great engineers to the company, they will in turn recruit other great engineers. And talents of all kinds. So, it's very important that the thing we're working on is intrinsically interesting, and generally that's a high energy environment. if the work is intrinsically interesting and they're making progress, then you just sort of attract more and more great engineers. Where you stop doing really interesting things, and then they leave.
Okay. Yeah.
And that's a pretty straightforward. They also want to make sure you've got a recruiting function that is very good. And that if somebody great wants to join the company, that they actually get an interview. But this is actually one of my big worries, because like if Nicholas Tesla was alive today, could he get an interview? And if not, we're doing something wrong. Like, I'm not totally sure if we get it. So and we're like, so if one of the most willing engineers ever could maybe not get an interview, we should fix that and make sure we're not like barring the doors from talent. Or that we're looking at the right things. Like generally they'll look for things that are like evidence of exceptional ability. I don't care if somebody graduated from college or high school or whatever. What evidence of exceptional ability? Just give me three bullet points, evidence of exceptional ability. Get graduated from college is not, that's okay.
Yeah.
But, did they build some really impressive device, win some really tough competition, come up with some great ideas, solve some really tough problems? It's like, what did they do that just was like, your evidence of exceptional ability. It's not necessarily a 4.0 GPA, that's what it is, but that's considered to be a quantum indicator.
Okay, all right, clear evidence of exceptional ability.
Yes.
I like that one. Okay, so Elon, I want to give you the last minute or so for Elon to be Elon, right?
Okay.
So you have here, this is Air Force Space Pitch Day. You have in the audience small businesses, developing new and innovative capabilities for the space domain. You have Air Force Space Command operators, Air Force space acquisition folks. You have congressional staffers. You have some media. You've got experts in the valley in the audience. What is the one thing or two things that you want to tell them all about Air Force Space Pitch Day and how it is to be successfully growing a small business to a large business?
Okay, well, I think it's like, it's intrinsically good to grow a small business to a large business. Sometimes a small business should be a small business. Sometimes businesses shouldn't exist. So, like, a company is a group of people cost of